Daily Words of God. Throughout the entire management work, the most important work is man's salvation from the influence of Satan. The key work is the complete conquest of corrupt man, thus restoring the original reverence of God in the heart of conquered man, and allowing him to achieve a normal life, which is to say, the normal life of a creature of God. This work is crucial and is the core of the management work. In the three stages of the work of salvation, the first stage of the work of the age of law was far from the core of the management work. It only had the slight appearance of the work of salvation, and was not the beginning of God's work of saving man from the domain of Satan. The first stage of work was done directly by the Spirit because, under the law, man only knew to abide by the law and did not have more truth, and because the work in the age of law hardly involved changes in the disposition of man, much less was it concerned with the work of how to save man from the domain of Satan. Thus, the Spirit of God completed this supremely simple stage of work that did not concern the corrupt disposition of man. This stage of work bore little relation to the core of the management and had no great correlation to the official work of the salvation of man. And so it did not require God to become flesh to personally do his work. The work done by the Spirit is implied and unfathomable, and it is fearful and unapproachable to man. The Spirit is not suited to directly doing the work of salvation, and is not suited to directly providing life to man. Most suitable for man is to transform the work of the Spirit into an approach that is close to man, which is to say, what is most suitable for man is for God to become an ordinary, normal person to do his work. This requires God to be incarnated, to replace the work of the Spirit, and for man, there is no more suitable way for God to work. Among these three stages of work, two stages are carried out by the flesh, and these two stages are the key phases of the management work. The two incarnations are mutually complementary and perfect each other. The first stage of God's incarnation laid the foundation for the second stage, and it can be said that the two incarnations of God form one whole and are not incompatible with each other. These two stages of God's work are carried out by God in His incarnate identity because they are so important to the entire management work. It could almost be said that, without the work of the two incarnations of God, the entire management work would have ground to a halt, and the work of saving mankind would be nothing but empty talk. Whether or not this work is important is based on the needs of mankind and the reality of mankind's depravity and the severity of Satan's disobedience and its disturbance of the work. The right one who is up to the task is predicated upon the nature of his work and the importance of the work. When it comes to the importance of this work, in terms of what method of work to adopt, work done directly by the Spirit, or work done by God incarnate, or work done through man, the first to be eliminated is work done through man, and based on the nature of the work, and the nature of the Spirit's work versus that of the flesh, it is ultimately decided that work done by the flesh is more beneficial for man than work done directly by the Spirit and offers more advantages. This is God's thought at the time to decide whether the work was done by the Spirit or by the flesh. There is a significance and basis to each stage of work. They are not groundless imaginings, nor are they carried out arbitrarily. There is a certain wisdom in them. Such is the truth behind all of God's work. In particular, there is even more of God's plan in such a great work as God incarnate, personally working among man. And so, God's wisdom and the entirety of His being are reflected in His every action, thought, and idea in working. This is God's being that is more concrete and systematic. These subtle thoughts and ideas are difficult for man to imagine, and difficult for man to believe, and moreover, difficult for man to know. Work done by man is according to general principle, which, for man, is highly satisfactory. Yet compared to the work of God, there is simply too great a disparity. Although the deeds of God are great, and the work of God is of a magnificent scale, behind them are many minute and precise plans and arrangements that are unimaginable to man. Every stage of his work is not only according to principle, but also contains many things that cannot be articulated by human language. And these are the things that are invisible to man. Regardless of whether it is the work of the Spirit or the work of God incarnate, each contains the plans of his work. He does not work groundlessly and does not do insignificant work. When the Spirit works directly, it is with his goals. And when he becomes man, which is to say, when he transforms his outer shell to work, it is even more with his purpose. Why else would he change his identity freely? Why else would he become a person who is regarded as lowly and is persecuted?